Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one, I call Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the most recent Police Scotland officer and staff number statistics showing the number of police officers in Police Scotland's Edinburgh Division.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, the latest statistics on police officer numbers were published earlier this week, showing there were 48 more officers deployed in Edinburgh as of 31st of December compared to the same point in 2022. Additionally, the city's E division are able to access specialist regional and national expertise when required to meet demand. I very much welcome the Chief Constable's commitment to restarting officer recruitment in March following the positive budget settlement for policing in the draft 2024-25 budget. This means that the Chief Constable will have more officers available to deploy on top of the almost 1,480 officers recruited since the beginning of 2022.
Sue Webber.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. But since the SNP Government decided to merge Scotland's police forces into one, it has had a devastating impact on the visible footprint of police officers in our communities. And despite the Cabinet Secretary's response there, in Edinburgh Police Division alone, there has been a drop of 76 officers. That's more than 1 in 20 officers being lost in just over a decade. It is no wonder that recorded violent crimes in Edinburgh have increased by 10% in just the last year alone. Cabinet Secretary, why has this SNP government left our hard-working police to fend for themselves in the face of rising violent crime?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as I'm sure the member is well aware, that since this government took office in 2007, that actually Scotland is now safer. Recorded crime is at one of the historic lows since 1974. And since this government took office, there has been a decrease in recorded crime by 40%. And of course, I would remind the member that our police officers remain the best paid in the UK, and that we continue to have more hard-working police officers now than we did than in terms of what we inherited in 2007.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. Whilst the UK Government continues to slash Scotland's public service funding, with the latest autumn statement imposing further damage after over a decade of austerity, the Scottish Government has supported our vital emergency services and increased pay for staff. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide detail on the funding in the recent draft budget and what it will mean for Police Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, if the UK Government aren't cutting public services and the Scottish Block Grant, they're also meddling with pension changes, which has a huge impact on, for example, the retention of police officers. But for this government, protecting frontline services and supporting those who deliver them is a key priority for this government, and that's why there is, despite challenging financial circumstances, a very good settlement for the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland in the draft budget, which means that we will invest £1.55 billion in policing in the next financial year. That is a significant increase, £75 million in terms of resource, and also a 12.5% increase in capital. And I very much hope that as this budget progresses, that we'll have the support of the Conservatives for the sake of policing in Scotland.
As ever, there's much interest in these questions. I'd be grateful if we could pick up the pace. And at question number two, I call Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure the availability of psychological services for all who need them.
Minister Marie Todd.
We want people in Scotland, regardless of their background or circumstances, to have access to the right help at the right time when they struggle with their mental or physical health. The Scottish Government published the National Specification for Psychological Therapies and Interventions in September 23 to support the delivery of this ambition. The specification sets out what people can expect when they are referred for a psychological therapy. It also details the evidence-based treatments and the whole system approach that services should offer. This includes a choice to access our much expanded range of digital interventions. Over 1.3 billion will be invested in mental health services and support in 24-25. The implementation of the specification will help to ensure that our NHS delivers psychological therapies to the highest standard and enable greater equity and consistency across Scotland.
Fulton MacGregor.
Yeah, I thank the Minister for that response. She'll be aware that I've recently written to her about the Lanarkshire Counselling and CBT Centre based in Coatbridge in my constituency. Set up in 2019, this service has already provided therapy to over 9,000 people across Lanarkshire. They have over 100 therapists on hand and can provide individual counselling and group work. And crucially, there is no waiting list, so people can access the support when they need it. People locally seem to really value this service, and this is undoubtedly having the effect of taking pressure from other NHS health services. I wonder if the Minister would be open to visiting the centre and discussing with them further supports available to allow them to continue to provide this service and meet their increasing demand.
Minister.
Our mental health and wellbeing strategy is absolutely clear in the need for a wide range of options to provide support for those who need it. I'm aware of the member's letter and I'll respond as soon as I can. I welcome him drawing this to my attention and I appreciate the additional support that the centre is providing in Lanarkshire. We continue to work with NHS boards across Scotland to offer high-quality, enhanced and specialist psychological care by implementing the new national specification for psychological therapies, and we're focusing on increasing access for the public to free, evidence-based therapies throughout the NHS.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recent figures show that one in four consultant psychiatrist roles are currently vacant, and all the while the government is freezing the mental health budget again and failing to meet its waiting time targets. Does the Minister accept that the mental health can only be a priority for the government when they start treating it as such?
Minister.
So we are continuing to invest record amounts into mental health provision across the country to ensure that people's needs are met effectively, safely and in a timely fashion. We are working in an unprecedented financial situation, and this may lead to difficult decisions about future investment. However, we remain committed to supporting all boards to achieve the standard that 90% of patients start treatment within 18 weeks of referral, and to improving the quality as well as the choice of treatments. There's a suite of work going on across the board, from medical student level to consultant level, to increase the number of psychiatrists and the number of trainees at every level. And we have had recently, we've had huge investment in psychological therapies, so clinical psychology numbers have gone up. And as a result of that work, the median waiting time now from referral to being seen when referred for psychological therapies is a mere 3 weeks.
Thank you. We are going to have concise questions and responses from this point in to enable more members to contribute. Question number three, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it has conducted an analysis of the potential impact that its 2024-25 budget will have on primary care services.
Minister Jenny Minto.
The budget invests over £2.1 billion in primary care to improve preventative care in the community, supporting the development of multidisciplinary teams in general practice, sustaining NHS dental care through enhanced fees and continuing free eye examinations. In-depth analysis of specific primary care service requirements were fed into budget considerations at both official and ministerial level. For example, delivery projections for multidisciplinary teams were assessed using six-monthly primary care improvement plan trackers, while for dentistry and optometry, which are predominantly demand-led lines, forecast models and estimates of activity were prepared to inform budget allocation. In addition to assessment of financial need, equality impact assessments were conducted as necessary to support changes in policy and can be found on the budget web pages.
Liz Smith.
Thank you, but we know that GP numbers have decreased since 2017 to fewer than 3,500 whole-time equivalents, with demand obviously increasing very substantially. Is there not now a strong case for reconfiguring the health budget so that there is more emphasis on primary care?
Minister.
Scotland continues to have a higher number of GPs per head of population than the rest of the UK. We have record numbers of GPs working in Scotland are committed to increasing this number further. The GP headcount is now sitting consistently at over 5,000, with an increase of 271 additional GPs since 2017. We also invest over £1 million per annum in a range of recruitment and retention initiatives so that working as a GP in Scotland remains an attractive career choice.
Question number four, Russell Findlay.
To ask the Scottish Government, in light of the COVID-19 inquiry, what its response is to reports that Scottish Government decisions appear to have been taken for purely political reasons, including comments made by the former First Minister's Chief of Staff regarding seeking a good old-fashioned rammy with the UK Government.
Minister George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The comments that Mr Findlay refers to were extracted from evidence regarding the furlough scheme which was controlled by the UK Government. This was for a purpose and to deliver results to push the UK Government into action on making sure furlough was going to be available to the people of Scotland if the Scottish Government wanted to apply restrictions. Throughout the pandemic, our sole focus and intention was to protect the people of Scotland from the harms of COVID-19, and the Scottish Government, Presiding Officer, remains wholly committed to assisting the UK and Scottish COVID-19 inquiries in all their work.
Before I call Mr Findlay, I would ask Mr Lumsden to refrain from commenting. Mr Findlay, Russell Findlay.
Thank you. These comments were not from some junior civil servant or backbencher. They were said by the former First Minister Nicola Sturgeon's right-hand woman. Her closest adviser, Liz Lloyd, was one of the most powerful people in government with huge influence over key COVID decisions, including the numbers allowed at funerals and weddings. So when she said the SNP should act for purely political reasons and provoke a rammy with the UK government, we should believe her. And doesn't this show the very worst of the SNP's toxic nationalist agenda, exploiting a pandemic to try and drive a wedge between the people of the UK?
Minister George Adam.
First and foremost, Presiding Officer, I found Mr Findlay's term, use of language there, repulsive, and the fact that he was talking regarding COVID-19 and the families who have had to suffer during that period. But Mr Findlay's supplementary question was a bit confused at best, but I'll endeavour, as always, Presiding Officer, to try and give the member an answer. As I said in my original answer, this was for a purpose, to deliver results for the people of Scotland, to protect them from harm and ensure that they had financial liquidity during a very difficult period in our recent past. Surely, Presiding Officer, Mr Findlay thinks that's a good thing for the people of Scotland.
Question number five, Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what criteria it considers when determining how to allocate funding for humanitarian aid in situations such as those in Gaza.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Presiding Officer, the primary mechanism for Scottish Government to respond to humanitarian crisis is through our Humanitarian Emergency Fund. Decisions on which crisis to respond to through the HEF are made by Scottish ministers based on recommendations from a panel of eight leading humanitarian aid organisations. In addition, we recently responded to emergencies in Pakistan, Malawi, Ukraine, Turkey and Syria and Gaza. Key considerations in these cases are which organisations are already on the ground and can provide a rapid response and value for money. This was the case for Gaza, and similarly last week when I announced £500,000 to respond to a deadly cholera epidemic in Zambia through the Red Cross.
Bill Kidd.
Thank the Minister very much for that. The humanitarian crisis we've seen unfold in Gaza is truly harrowing and is worsening by the day, underscoring the need for urgent action. Does the Minister agree with me that the only way to ensure mutual peace and security is through the recognition of a Palestinian state alongside a binding commitment to the two-state solution? And can they say what representations the Scottish Government has made to the UK Government with regards to such recognition?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I don't think anyone can look at the images that we're seeing on our TV screens every day and not realise that we need a ceasefire now in order to bring about progress to peace. And I really wish all the sides well and continue to do that. We would add our voice to that. The Scottish Government supports a two-state solution. We think it's the only way to progress to peace. And in November last year, the First Minister wrote to the Prime Minister in these terms, and we will continue to do that, make those representations to the UK Government as this issue continues. And today is another example of the Scottish Government, you know, calling on the UK Government to get round the table, call for the ceasefire and get some progress to peace in order to support the people, the civilians in Gaza.
Brief supplementary, Jamie Green.
I think all of us despair in the ongoing conflict and crisis that is happening the world over, but that is my point. There is conflict the world over. So in that vein, can I ask, the Minister what criteria the Scottish Government uses to decide where and to whom it sends financial aid and what due diligence it undertakes before and during such financial payments.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I can ensure that Jamie Green gets more details on our humanitarian emergency fund and the partners that we have in that. Eight leading humanitarian aid organisations are involved in that decision-making process. And when they alert us to an ongoing or a possible crisis, that's when we take their advice and decide whether they meet the criteria to have some funding from the Humanitarian Emergency Fund. It's a very well rehearsed and organised system that we have in place, and I'll ensure that Jamie Green gets more detail on the HEF and maybe some conversations with key partners like Oxfam, who give us a sit rate almost every day on the situation in Gaza.
Question number 6, David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure that all legal predatory control is carried out in a way that is consistent with the best practice in animal welfare standards.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I recognise that control of predators is sometimes necessary in order to protect livestock and other vulnerable species. However, this Government is committed to the highest standards of animal welfare. We're demonstrating this through provisions that we're bringing forward in the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Bill, for example, to ban the use of glue traps and snares. We're also seeking to license the use of certain cage and spring traps to ensure trapping is only undertaken in line with best practice for animal welfare.
David Torrance.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The Minister will be aware that the Oxford Centre for Animal Ethics report coined Kill to Kill, which examines the trapping and killing of animals so more grouse can be shot for sport. Can I ask if this ethical issue will be addressed through a Wildlife Management and Muirburn Scotland Bill?
Minister.
Yes, it absolutely has been addressed, and the Killing to Kill report highlighted that 39% of species trapped in a range of traps are non-target species, such as hedgehogs and indeed protected species like badgers. Our recent decision to ban the use of snares in Scotland is part due to their indiscriminate nature and the unacceptable risk that they pose to non-target species, including other wildlife and indeed domestic species. We've heard many reports of domestic cats being caught in snares. So further to this, the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Bill will require that individuals using traps to capture live birds, such as Larsen or crow cage traps, will have to undertake training in order to hold a licence. These traps, when operated in line with best practice, have a much lower risk of trapping non-target species.
Question number 7, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government what support will be put in place to assist local authorities in establishing areas of linguistic significance as set out in the Scottish Languages Bill. Gus Feinjoch de Realtis na Halapa, Jen Taishke, Visound, the Ruchteris and Innithil, Aharshan, Archich and Aharsarichche, Huvchan and Ischeher.
Minister, Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
The designation of areas of linguistic significance will ultimately be a matter for local authorities. For areas that may wish to be designated as areas of linguistic significance, there is already a range of Gaelic support and provision in place. This includes both the central Scottish Government funding support, the commitments of public bodies and of local activity from Gaelic community organisations. This support will be built on and strengthened by the new provisions in the Scottish Languages Bill, and guidance will also be prepared to assist local authorities in their process of considering areas within their local area which could benefit from designation.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. Can she say any more at present about whether the Scottish Government or Bord na Gaelic may seek to place a duty on local authorities to establish an area of linguistic significance where, for example, a high proportion of the population were Gaelic speakers?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as Dr Allen will be aware, that it's fair to say there are a range of different opinions on this matter, but I would expect that during the parliamentary consideration there will be views offered that suggest that Scottish Government or Bord na Gaelic should have an enhanced role in the designation of areas of linguistic significance. We're obviously still at a very early stage in relation to the legislation itself, but I do give the member an assurance today that I will give serious consideration to those views and indeed any observations which, of course, the Education Committee may wish to make.